Pray. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the food today, Lord. We thank you for those that are preparing it, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for being our total provision, Lord. Lord, we just give you the praise, give you the glory, Lord. We start off our day, Lord, inviting you into our presence, Lord. Because we're two or three are gathered in your name, there you are, Lord. Father, we just thank you today. Bless the food. Also bless the meal that you serve, Lord, through your word in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sam, I'm waiting on an update for Jim.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Yeah.
He stopped by the center the other day, and he looked good, actually. But
he's been in and out of the hospital, right?
Yeah, but he said he refused the chemo on the kidney.
You know, that's really a personal thing in your prayer life. I haven't dealt with cancer before. Wife actually refused chemo at the time because it was after prayer and stuff. She felt the Lord was telling her not to take chemo. She came under a lot of fire from a lot of different areas, including the doctors themselves. You know, but God did a miracle shortly after that, completely removed it out of her body.
Wow.
You know, so, and with the doctors right there seeing the difference, and also the birth of my oldest son took place very shortly after that, especially after advising her to abort my older son because it was going to be nothing but problems. Because of the cancer, in her case it was leukopenia, which was cancer of the blood of an undetermined origin. But you know, I never fault someone who's gone into prayer and asked God one way or the other whether they should take chemo or whether they shouldn't. Because it really is in a believer's life, you know, the choice comes while you're in prayer and feeling what God's leading you to do. You know, because we can be real cruel sometimes to the sick. And there's nothing worse than kicking a person when they're down. Sometimes that's what it can feel like. Having been on that very, you know, I've had well-meaning Christians, if you could call it that, come up and go, you know, the reason she's like this is because you fell down in your prayer life.
Well,
you know. Oh yeah.
Those are spiritual people. You got this sickness
because there's sin in your life. You need to,
right? Or you have sickness and sin in your life. That's the other one.
I heard that.
So we got to be careful with our words when we deal with the sick and afflicted. You know, we can encourage them in their walk is what we need to do, and they're seeking the Lord in the situation.
You know, you really got to be watchful on who lay hands on you and who prays for you.
You got to make sure they clean them.
You got to keep the alcohol sterilized up there. You know, those pastors, they want to lay hands on you after they came out of the bathroom or something.
Yeah,
you
know, I know, man.
Well, some things hadn't changed then.
No, but seriously, you know, like you say, well-meaning. I remember my wife, she had got into a car accident, and she was having some problems, you know. And so we had gone to this church. And again, well, the reason you're not healed is because you got sin. Man, and that all right there turned my wife off. You know, she still carries that thing, you know. And I don't blame her. I don't blame her, you know. And shortly after, the next day, actually, after they prayed for her, I went to work, and when I came back, she was laying on the ground. Couldn't move. I said, well, why didn't you call me? Well, I didn't want to bother you. What? we took her to the hospital.
It's kind of nice down there.
Her back, you know? And so we got to really be careful, you know, and how we encourage.
Yeah.
And these well-meaning saints that are not
judgmental.
Very judgmental, you know. So.
So when they said she had sin in her life, she didn't just automatically point to you?
That's a good one. But a bit, quit hanging out with him. Oh my God.
Man, I got a bad rap for everything.
Oh, I'm telling you.
But I agree with you, man.
Those people, I love them, because as soon as they're done, I say, all right, now, can I help you with your plank out to the car? And they're like...
That's good.
Oh, yeah, they don't like me.
You know, what's sad is the biggest perpetrator of it all was actually one of the biggest elders in the church that I was attending at the time. You know? But it's just like punching you right in the stomach when someone does something.
Oh, yeah.
It's like being punched right in the stomach.
Yeah.
And as a young Christian,
I mean... I can put you in a tailspin.
Yeah. You know, another one, since we started that, another one is, my wife's has been sick for a very, very long time and has been on prescription drugs for a long, long time. And I've had well-meaning Christians again come up. You don't trust God. You need to just throw all the bills over in the corner and just trust Him. Well, guess what? When you're on mind medication and everything like that, and even if your heart's for the Lord, like my wife is, guess what she does? She listens to stupid advice. And toss them over the corner, and guess what? Right into the hospital she goes.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. You've got to be really careful what you say. You know, it's one thing to encourage a person to go into the presence of the Lord, and then that person receives instruction from the Lord, you know, how to do that. You know?
Yeah.
You know, it's like me. I have some certain health issues that... They'll tell you straight off, you don't fast with these health conditions.
No.
Okay?
No.
And, you know, I'm not going to fast unless in my course of getting up in the morning and talking to the Lord or whatever He lays on my heart, I want you to do a fast. Then it's how long do you want me to do the fast, you know. But I'm seeking instruction from Him before I even attempt to do something like that, you know, because I can send my whole system into shock and the whole nine yards and actually create a bigger problem than. So I think we get ahead of God a lot of times, or we just don't seek God to make the decision. You know, but again, we have to be careful what we advise people.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I know with my...
I think you're right in a way, but I'd like to add my two sentences. I think God lets everybody be responsible for their own life, and we really can't take care of their core essence. That's their responsibility, to be a support person, to be kind, to be caring, to try to do the best we can is all we could do. And we had to go to bed and think that we did the best we could, and that's what God wanted us to do. So whatever happens with them is their choice, and God's working with them as He is with us.
Now, I know in my own disease, you know, I didn't start anything without going to God in prayer and really being directed what He wanted me to do. And I knew He could heal me as a miracle, but I also knew He directed me to seek out, you know, some medical help, see what meds were available and stuff. And I had faith all along that He was going to heal me, whether it was a miracle or I got a liver transplant or whatever came down the pike, you know. And well-meaning Christians came to me with the same thing, you know what I mean? But when you've already gone to God and you know you're on the path that He's directed you on, you don't, well, at least I didn't. I didn't waver. I just kept pursuing what I felt. I mean, there were doors open for me that I couldn't even explain. You know what I mean? And there was other ones that looked like they were open that closed that I just took it as, okay, God, you don't want me to do that. You know what I mean? And through it all, he got me through it, you know? I'm tied to see clear today. They call me cured, so I'm believing it. Just went to the doctor Thursday, guys. Said, you're doing amazing.
I think that we've been blessed in not having that type of experience. Makes me want to ask a lot of questions. But the foremost question should be, how do you respond? When somebody comes to you, if we just sit and talk about things that happen, that could be gossip. But let's go to what the cure is. In other words, if somebody comes up, when somebody came up to you and said what they said to you, how did you respond? What's the question?
Oh, okay. You want to take it first, or does that matter?
I just told them that I am pursuing what God's telling me to do, and you know, they're not me. They can't live my life. They don't have my prayer life. They don't have my relationship with God. So don't judge me. You know, just watch for the results, because God's going to get the glory out of this one way or the other. You know, that's what
I've had many people thus saith the Lord,
and I didn't care if I went home to be with him. It was still okay. I won anyway, either way.
Yeah, I had a lot of people come in my life and say thus saith the Lord. Really? And I said, okay. Okay, I put that as, I take that into consideration.
Yeah.
And that's all I could do, you know, because, again, well meaning people, you know, and sometimes, you know, you want to hear thus saith the Lord if it was the Lord, right. You know? And, but if it's not, then, you know, okay, I've had years when I started going to church and being involved with the promise keepers and all that stuff. I have people prophesy or prophesy or whatever you want to call it, stuff over my life. And so, you know, I'm still waiting on some of those things, you know, not to say that God won't do it.
Sorry to prophesy, but don't prop up a lie.
And so you kind of got to watch what people say, take it with a grain of salt. And I just smile at them, and I take in consideration or whatever. And you know, don't be little, because those people actually do think they're doing something, you know. But sometimes they
I was always courteous and thanked them, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because then I would search, you know, make sure that I was doing what God prompted me to do. You know?
I think also it depends on the person that's come up to you and said these things, how you respond to them.
Yeah.
You know, like, of course, there's always, if you're an older Christian and a younger Christian comes up to you and obviously is thinking in the black and white, God in the box type thinking, you know, you know, knowing that in itself, you can gently respond to something like that. But if it's the other way around, where it's an older Christian, sometimes just being quiet and letting it be is a better thing, because most of the time they'll come back and really whip you with the word. Whether it's correct to do it in the way that it's done or not, you know. So sometimes no responses. You have to ask the Lord, really, how do we respond to this during the time that you're in the situation?
Yeah. My first pastor, when I started going to the training for home groups, meeting groups and stuff, and I asked him, you know, we got all these people who would say this and this and that, whatever, you know. And he said, well, this is, I tell everybody this. This is how I respond. Like, you listen with a little smile and let it go over your head, you know what I mean? And because sometimes there's not a response. Sometimes if you do respond, I'm not responding the right way. So, and again, it's well-meaning folks, you know, they're trying to just say this and that. So you just smile you know, and like you're going to take that in consideration. We have to be very careful, because when people say, "Thus says the Lord," and especially in the Pentecostal realm, where people are prophesying, but it's, you know, you could almost tell the minute the one word comes out that you could tell what they're going to say, because it's just like, you know, programmed in them. And I said, you know, God's got a new word, man. You know, God's got something different. And so, especially in the body of Christ, in the church, you know, and we have to be conscious of that when you speak out. But in the Pentecostal realm, you see a lot of that stuff going on. I said, is that the only person in the church that could bring the word, or something else, you know? So, you look at it, and my wife and I, we've been in many churches here lately, especially, and we just observe and we look and we check and you know, God bless them, because you know they love the Lord, they're doing service and all that, but you know, we've been at it, we've been beat up so hard, you know, we got the stripes to sell it, but again, it's well-meaning people. And you know, and people are doing things that they feel that is correct, you know. But some of us that are older, that we've been through that lesson already, and we know what the end result's going to be. And it's not a "thus says the Lord," it's "thus is what's going to happen," because you've been there, it happened to you. And so you just got, you know, if they don't listen or whatever like that, it's okay. So sometimes I've learned just to try to keep my mouth shut, because, you know, they're not going to listen anyway.
I think that's a good point, but, you know, I want to comment on something Fritz said. It really ties in what you're saying, too. In Timothy being instructed and mentored by Paul, you know, he said something that's just foreign to us. Be gentle, be patient. He said with gentleness. Our tendencies as male, alpha males, is come out with answers. To be quiet and to listen is one thing, but it should be tempered, I believe, scripturally, with tenderness. What we answer with, we can say 5 or 10 things that are right, and we know we're right, but we're wrong for saying them.
But or you can say them the wrong way. They could be right, but say them the wrong way.
Yeah. And you know, and that's right there. It's just, like for me, a guy recently has put somebody in my life that is teaching me patience.
Just recently?
He's not new.
And
gotta be his daughter and his wife.
I have fired this person about 5-10 times in my mind. And I got it planned. I was gonna do it today, but God is showing me that this person that is a well-meaning person, a well-loving person, that irritates the living daylights out of you, God placed that person in your life to teach you patience and tolerance, you know? And sometimes, you know, we look at things where you want to fire, get out, you know. When I had my business, I had a revolving door, man. I fire higher more than you could shake a stick at. Because if you're not doing the job right, you could tell if a person is good. But with this scenario, my people say, why don't you get rid of the person? And I says, I want to, but I can't. Because, you know, if there's something there. You got to look at the person and their heart. And so if you let go of that person, that maybe is not the right thing. So God is teaching me tolerance. That's why he put Glenn in my life. You know? And but he really, and thank God for those. You're the one.
You're the one.
I was just thinking about you. You're the one. You shared a. He preached at our church one day, and sandpaper, rubber bands, yeah. And that other thing. And I always remember that, you know, and because God put some sandpaper people in your life.
Staples, rubber bands, and paper clips.
What's a staple clip, though, bro?
staple of somebody that's really connected to you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, really, they're committed, you know what I mean? Paperclip somebody there, you know, but they're going to eventually say, yeah, I'm going to go somewhere else. A rubber band, they're like here and there and here.
Oh, my God, yeah. Where's the sandpaper coming?
There was no sandpaper. Yeah. Well, that's in your sand, head.
That was you.
That's the first 5 years of marriage.
Oh. I think we do grow with the sandpaper people. It causes us to grow and reflect. But it's like St. Francis talked about, let me understand as to be understood. And a lot of times when you understand, you're able to help and cope. And sometimes our experiences have helped us understand that this is a result of doing that. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we're blessed with wisdom without having to go through the experiences. And a simple example is like, okay, I'm blessed with the fact that I have Social Security and I have insurance. And I'm in a category where I'm older than 21. Well, my insurance company seems calling me like every week saying, you got to go in and get checked. You got to go this. You got to go do that. It's kind of like, will you please leave me alone? I'm having fun. I'm healthy. I'm working out. And I don't need to go in every month and get everything checked because I think I'm okay. Just because I'm in the category of everybody that gets sick and has to have blood tests and cancer tests and rectum tests and all that stuff, you know, I don't have to go do that. I don't have to buy into it because they're just trying to protect their economic overall. And they're putting me in that category, and I'm just saying, okay, fine, thank you for the opportunity to be in that category, but let me live my life the way I think I should be living my life with God with me on by my side.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like a joke that I tell the people. It's kind of like, okay, I didn't go in today and get my eyes checked because they're having a cattle call, and everybody's going to go to the doctor's office and get their eyes checked. Like, I can see okay. I don't think I need to go today.
Yeah, but you know what? Just a comment on that. It seems like when you're talking about these doctors, it seems like all of a sudden they get to send this message out. Well, everybody's got to get a colonoscopy, you know? All of, you know, anybody, you know, and so...
15
and up. I said, my God. And then all of a sudden you have to get this test, you know?
Next
like,
year.
You have money.
That's what the drugs...
Anyway, so if you understand a little bit,
some factual data too, but you know, the thing that I wanted to say is that, you know, I've heard, I'm sitting listening this morning, I've heard well-meaning said about 25 times. Not everybody in the church is well-meaning. There's no jerks in the church.
Sure.
And we got to call it like we see it. So when somebody comes to me with anything, the first thing that I do is not get defensive, but I pay attention to what's their motivation. Do they really care about me? Do they really love me? Do they really know Jesus? Do they know what they're talking about? Or they're just saying what they've heard somewhere else, or trying to be something that they're not, or, you know, or they don't like me. You know, what's their motivation? Why are they saying the things that they're saying? It's funny, you know, in this line of work, I get people saying, oh, you know, you must really like people. And I'm like, nah, not so much. It's the truth, you know, because I've seen it, you know, and you deal with the nonsense that comes with the kind of line of work. Like, she sat in my spot and someone's in my parking space and, you know, and all this stuff. And I'm like, well, I parked 2 blocks away. Praise God. Sit down. Shut up. Open your book. You know? So, not everybody...
Pastor, hug you
well-meaning.
And hug
yeah.
me.
So what we're doing now is we're trying to find the churches that are growing, the churches that are bigger now. You're finding out, like I am now in this subcategory called the recovery pastor, which there never was before. And these big churches now have senior pastors, lead pastors, campus pastors, care pastors. They go get one of the guy on their team that's good at doing that stuff and being one-on-one with families,
you know,
in crisis,
in the temple,
to counsel them and pray with them. And that guy, his only job is to do that now. He never preaches. He never does any of the sacraments. He just handles the crisis situations that come up throughout the week and months and years with those families. You know, he's the care pastor. He's good at that. I am not good at that. You know, I'm good at the motivational, tell you what to do, get off your behind, do something, change your life, help somebody else, get going.
Kick them in the butt.
You dig a hole, you know, I mean, that's what I do. So I'm like the, you know, the hammer, they call me. So...
I had a hammer.
You know, but you got to check people's motivation. And if their motivation's not right, then I can look at them and say, all right, well, thanks for sharing that with me. And then I can immediately discard it, or I pray about it later and find out, what is there a way I can help this person get beyond where they're at? Am I supposed to do that or not? It might not be my assignment. You know, there's a lot of people walking around, they're giving themselves assignments that are not theirs. You know, we're supposed to carry our cross. You know, not
you
someone else's
problem.
Yeah. So it's kind of fun to watch.
Come in two fisted.
How you doing? Good, man. You got room over there?
Yeah, dude.
Good morning.
How you feeling?
I feel good. I just overslept.
Feel it. Make sure you feel good.
Yeah, feels good. Feels like the right temperature, and he's sitting up straight.
There you go. Taking in nourishment, oxygen.
Let me call the care pastor.
I think that's empty, bro.
They'll be better at that.
Can we pass down some other
let
coffee?
Me see if he's that's alive. Empty. Let's see. Yeah. Problem on
this. Here's a full one.
Okay, thank you. Well, you know, and again, going back to that, you know, golly, I've been. In this crisis type ministry for a long time. Yep. I've seen people come, I've seen people go, I've seen walking the people. Yeah. I've seen the people that are the fly-by-nighters, or you know, they come
spiritual
by and
say, tumbleweed.
Oh, you're the best thing in the world.
That's what I call them.
Oh, I love you so much. Yeah. I want to be, you know, I've seen everything. And so, you know, now I look at people with my cross right there. And I just say, you know, if they're here for a season, praise God. If that's where you're at, it's okay, you know. But if you're gone, you know, look at this. Look at this ministry here. We've had a turnaround of people throughout the years, but we've had our core group. Because this core group that's been here all these years, because they've been focused on a relational aspect. And we don't even go to the same church, you know, but we are here because of a reason, and that's what God called us to do. But throughout our years, we've seen people come, and we've seen people go, and they leave for a season. You know, I just think about the wonderful opportunities that God has given us throughout the years, and the testimonies of the lives have been touching and healed through this ministry. And you might not see them, you know, for a while. We've had missionaries. You know, I always remember John Thielman, you know, the fact that John Thielman, that he was all the way in Africa. And he says that every day, every Friday, he says, I know my guys are praying for me, you know. And so that's powerful. And that's where the blessing is, you know, where you have that camaraderie, that relationship. And guess what? I don't see you half you guys out during the week, you know, just on once a week. But it has nothing to do with that. It has to do with a relationship that what here is for real, you know. Ain't nobody out of here blowing smoke out of somebody's blowing smoke anyway for you to watch. But you know, it's a real thing, and that to me is so important because you know, it's just a testimony of what the body is supposed to be like. This is the body, you know, where we have different churches, denominations, and who cares? We're just here as one. And dealing with, you know, issues and problems and loving on one another, you know. And that's the body. That's the body, man. I thank God for that, you know. I get off my soapbox.
But I also think that, you know, God equips, like he was saying, certain people to deal with certain situations that others wouldn't deal with. Don't want to deal with, come into the whole situation with a prejudged idea, you know. And you know, you hear that all the time about where the serial killer, you know, ends up in prison and then gets led to the Lord by somebody, and then the next day in the churches it's like, oh, God can't deal with that guy. He can't, you know. That it's like his grace is not good enough
for everybody. There's certain exceptions.
Too good for some people.
Yeah, like for Hitler and this and that. You know, and I've run into it in another area years ago when I was doing some work for another Christian group that had rescue mission and stuff. And I had to sit down at the table right straight across from a guy that was a pedophile, you know, and look him in his eyes and listen to him crying and sobbing about the feelings that he had and why he molested children and stuff. Meantime, I've got two boys myself at the time. So, you know, all these feelings are going through me and stuff, you know, but God gave me the grace to be able to listen to the man and share with the man, maybe plant a seed or two with the man. You know, I'm not saying I led him back to the Lord or anything, but I did plant some seeds, you know, and such. But there are so many, and if you were like abused by an alcoholic father or whatever, and then all of a sudden you're dealing with alcoholics, you know, you're not coming from a non-judgmental mind.
Yeah.
I mean, you're... First thing in the situation is you can tell it. They got a problem, and I didn't like what was done to me, and I don't like the feelings that I'm feeling while I'm talking with this. Go ahead, Doc.
No, just so many times I know in conversation that if I'm upset, I have to look at why I'm upset. And a lot of times I have that same character defect. Lord has a way of putting you in front of people for you to realize that plank. You know, carry that plank out of the room.
God created it all. It's all part of His plan. And the one little point that I wanted to add to it, and this was talking about, was Hitler. Unfortunately, I've read a lot of books, but fortunately, some of the wisdom has come out there. And you know, some guy was talking about that, Hitler's horrors. If it wasn't for him, there wouldn't be an Israel. They paid a heck of a price to get a country, but now they have a place to go that's home, and it's a wonderful place to be, from what I hear, if you have the Jewish faith to protect yourself in a community based under God. And that wouldn't be today if it wasn't for Hitler. Strange reality, but God made Hitler too. I'm not saying I judge him, and I think if I had to, he was a hard man, a living devil. But it's God's plan, it's not mine.
You know, what you said there, I was brought a word yesterday in revival. Any of y'all ever listen to Jason Franklin?
Yeah.
I love Jason Franklin. He made a point last Sunday, and he was talking about that the devil spoke into the ear of the Pharaoh. And he told the Pharaoh that the Messiah is going to be born. And so out of that, because of that, and because of the fear, that he massacred all those children. But God always protected his own with Moses. Then the devil spoke again into another Pharaoh's ear, tell him that the Messiah is coming. And then what happened, all those babies were being killed, and because they wanted to exterminate or get rid of that Messiah that was coming. But yet God always takes care of his own. And only today, that as the real Zion is speaking, is that, you know, there are a million babies a year that are being massacred, that are being killed. And the fear is because the devil spoke into somebody's ear that the Messiah is coming. And so out of that, the ministry, the church is born. Out of chaos, out of trouble, out of things of this nature that bring people together. The church triumphs when there is tragedy. When 9/11 happened, who was there? Who's the first responder? When the Katrina happened, in Louisiana? Who's the first responder and who's still there? You know, God's given us, the church, the opportunity today as being the responders, the first responders to the crisis that we're living in today. With, you know, 9/11, never before in the history of the United States or the founding of the United States, God has put a hedge of protection around this country until 9/11. Because he lifted off that hedge, because of the sin, the sin that we are perpetrating today, you know, with abortion, homosexuality, same-sex marriage, and all these things that are going on, and the covering of God is what's lifted, as we're seeing. Never before has this country ever been attacked. With all the wars that we've had, never has this country been attacked until that veil was lifted. And then 9/11 came. And now as we're seeing terrorists and things are going on. And, you know, and God, in this time, such a time as this, that God is lifting up a remnant of his people that have the heart and the guts, like Joshua, to go out and share the gospel and minister to the least of them. And he's given us the grace, and he's given us the love to do that. And people look at us that are in the prison ministries and doing the things that we do as they're praying. How can they do that? How can they talk to a pedophile? How can they talk to a rapist? How can they talk to the alcoholic? But you know what? If it wasn't for the grace of God, we might have been one of them. And so we got the greatest opportunity in the world, you know, because of what happened. A nation was born. A nation came together in strife, and to build a nation, because Christ would never let go of Israel. We know the covering over that. But we suffered all that. But I thank God, because at such a time as this, that as we come together to glorify God, minister the gospel, we have the opportunity today that we've never had before like it is today, because this country is in crisis. And so when we talk about it, we encourage one another, we build and we speak on the word, we're able to believe here and help somebody else. Right? I'm done.
I also think that, you know, the darker times get, you don't have to become any more light than what you are. Because the darker it gets, the more the light stands out. You know, so we each have Christ within us. You know, we each reflect him, you know, his light. And when darkness comes in, we're going to stand out more and more. You know, we can either do it voluntarily when times are good, or it will naturally come on you when times get rough. People see Christ in you and such. So a darkness is right now is not necessarily a bad thing. A lot of times it's something to encourage God's people.
It's always darkest before the dawn.
Yeah.
The thing that we have to remember also too is that things don't always go the way God planned them, you know, but God promises to use all things, work them for our good, for those who love him and are called according to his will and purpose. So, did God intend for 6 million people to be killed so that they could have a state? No. But did he turn something that disgusting into something beautiful? Yeah. So when I do the work that I do, when I'm sitting across from those people that, you know, the guy that's there for the rest of his life because he murdered his parents, or set fire to a school, or did some of the horrible things and killed a bunch of kids. I deal with these guys face to face every day. But I know that, you know, their plans and some of the things, and most of the guys that have committed the crimes, and I'm not trying to get on a soapbox, it's all drugs and alcohol first. I can look at any file and I can promise you that no matter what it says, there's drugs and alcohol in there somewhere. It's bad choices they made under the influence, or bad choices they made to get more, or a deal that went bad or something, but their life got way off track, and then God was not able to, because he's not going to impose his will on us. So you're kind of free running, you know, and you've blocked yourself from any hedge of protection that we're entitled to. So, you know, it's open season for the devil to come at you. So not only are you making really bad choices, but, you know, you're open season. So, you know, they end up in horrible places and do horrible things. And then if they come to the full knowledge of who Christ is and who they're supposed to be in Christ, it's a really hard thing to recognize, holy crap, did I get it wrong? Way wrong. And for some of them, they'll never, ever be free again. In spite of the fact that some of them now are some of the most thoughtful Christians I know now. But, you know, I wouldn't want to know them back then, you know. So it's just, it's kind of a thing that we've got to remember that, you know, that God can take anything and work it for good if it's according to his purpose. And our job is just to just keep on keeping on, despite what other people do around us. You know, whether they're doing right or wrong, it doesn't matter. I know what I'm supposed to be about. You know, I know how I'm supposed to treat people, whether anybody else treats me that way. One of the bravest people I know, every night he prays, God, please let people tomorrow treat me like I treated them today. Now, that takes a set to be able to pray that way. You know, let everybody tomorrow treat me like I treated them today. You got to be pretty steadfast in that you're doing a good job.
You know, one of the last greatest revivals that we've had, because, you know, I was studying that for the sermon I did, but I never realized it, but believe it or not, it was Promise Keepers. There was millions of men that came to the Lord because of that ministry. The stadiums were filled. After I'm one of those people that was impacted by that revival, where men were actually coming together for the glory of men. Because see, God said he will call the men, the heart back to the Father. He will call the men. And it's our job as men to take on that banner. Pray and carry that banner, as because God calling his men. He's not calling the women. But the problem that we have today is that the women have heard the call and they stepped in because the men haven't. But God is calling the men. He's assembled the men. And, you know, just to think about one of the biggest conference that we've ever had in this in Pinellas County was the Promise Keepers, 50,000 plus at the stadium.
The only times the Trop was ever full was Christian events, and one of them was Promise Keepers.
And
where are all those guys now?
And the importance of men's ministry is so vital, because we have to take and build and encourage these men to stand up for the banner of Christ. You know, and the most powerful part about that revival, which every other revival, there was no denominational lines there. It was a Baptist, Catholic, Methodist, whatever. They were all there because they were all serving the one and only true God. That's Christ. See, that's what God called us to. And we have the opportunity to affect the life of many people if we take up that banner and says, here I am, Lord, send me. Send me, send us. Let us work together for the glory to help these men that are in jail, those that are coming out that can't find jobs, those that have the stigma of pedophiles or thief or murder, and people look down their noses at them because of what they've done, because of whatever situation happened. But yet God looks at these men and women that have committed these things, and God says, come to me, my children, and he forgives them. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Of the belief, God created everything.
I don't believe that God is everything. I believe God is a man and a woman at the same time. I think that literary style of he through the Bible is historically documented to mean the human race. I don't believe it's just as a man. I believe we're guided by the Lord as men to take care of our work. But all of us have had a mother that bore us, that was, we were created through. The Lord used the female body to have us created. We've all been nurtured by women. We've all been taken care of by women. And the unit of man and woman is the essence of what it's all about. And when the men don't get it, the women do step in and say, hey, son, guess what? You're messing up. I want you to try this. But they're still taking care of the fundamentals. They're still taking care of the home. They're still taking care of it all. And it's about time, and I'm glad it's about time, that we've had the opportunity and our attempt to be a more perfect union to allow that to happen. And I think that that's part of God's plan and why we say this country under God. And I believe it's supposed to be that way. My little two cents. Women are just as important as men in so many ways. I'm adding to what you're saying.
Yeah,
I am.
I agree because, like I said, you know, if you look in the scriptures, you talk about Ruth and many others in the Bible that step in there, and you know, and God used them mightily. We can't take that away from them, you know. But the reality, a primary principle that God called, he called the men. And but because we haven't put on that banner, or it's easier to let them go ahead and do it instead of we doing it. So when God calls his men, and you have a revival of men, like what they have with Promise Keepers and stuff, where I've seen big, I went to a conference, man, where all pastors and all the pastors were crying, and this big, huge, 10-foot giant had beer down here, hugged me, and I had beer all up in my face. And the spot on me, but the brokenness of these men in these places. I've had men come to me and cry in my shoulders, saying that they want to help, but the pastors won't let them. You know, and I said, well, go find your pastor that will. They come and saw him. He said he was so happy because now he's serving the Lord in a greater way. And go ahead. I see you going. I see you fly away.
I want to tie this all into what we've actually been dealing with for the last 2 months or whatever. And it's sanctification. Because this is what it's all about. To be set apart by God for a task, you know, sanctification, to be made holy, is something you can't do on your own, right? If you try to sanctify yourself, you're going to fail, because you can never have sinless perfection, as some of the groups claim that they have reached, you know. But you know, the depravity of man and the fall from man, I don't believe there's any way you can be made perfect on the earth. Okay, now there's that point when we go to heaven that the situation changes, because, you know, that which is perfect will come. You know. But our maturity, you know, we can fill stadiums with people like that and God can outpour like that. Where does it go from there? You know, and I think that has a lot to do with sanctification, because the Holy Spirit does the work in each believer and he sets them up for their particular calling. You know, you're a three-part being, fall of Adam, right? You know, your spirit, you become separated from God. That word death there doesn't necessarily mean physical type death. It means separation from God. And he placed that angel there to prevent Adam from going back in, you know, till his plan was fulfilled in Christ. You know, so we were justified by faith, right? When we come to the Lord, it's by grace you are saved, through faith, gift to God, not of works. You cease from your works. Faith, he did it. You know, the Father, Christ, when he comes to you, he does the work of conversion. You know?
Amen.
That's just the redemption of one part of you. The other part is your sanctification. You know, that's why we're on the earth. That's what God, we're trying to do. God, your will, not my will, be done. You know, your soul man is your mind, your will, and your emotions. Your mind has to line up with the Word of God. Right? Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you're still living in your past nature. Right? Your will, not my will, but your will be done. You know? That's the second point of restoration of you, is to do the will of God, to come back into what you were created for originally to be. Okay? And then your emotions. How many people, their emotions drive who they are in Christ? They haven't learned who they are in Christ. It's not how you feel. You know? But many times we allow our emotions to rule our destiny, so to speak. Okay, so we get your that. Well, first we got your justification. Then we have your sanctification. And then the third part is your glorification. Right? Your glorification of your body. Because in this body dwells no good thing. So guess what happens when you die? Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. It's history. And what's God do when we go to be with him? He gives us a new body. Thereby, that whole redemption process has been fulfilled. Amen?
The nut leaves and there's nothing but a shell.
And this is the importance of Christian growth and sanctification being set apart by God's Word. The work that he's going to do with you, through you, with the Holy Spirit as the one that does it.
You know, bless you. I remember the title of one of the conferences that I went, and that was called Fans of Flame. And I was thinking about that fire there that is dying now, you can't actually see it. But when you blow on it, the amber gets red and it starts to come out again. See, I believe that God has poured his spirit upon all men. And I believe that the amber that is in us, and it's coming to a time that God is blowing on that amber so that fire will reignite, and then men will take their responsibility, their roles in what we're supposed to do, to share the gospel, to minister to the lost, to the poor, and to the needy, to be the men that we're supposed to be in our homes, to take care of our children, our wives, and that, and sharing the gospel of what God called us to do, is still our responsibility. God gave us the call. God gave us the responsibility to share that gospel. It wasn't given to the woman, but it was given to the man. Not to take nothing away from them, because, man, they're our helpmates. They're our helpmates. Thank God, if I hadn't had a wife, a helpmate, like Yvette, where would I be? But see, that's what I'm saying, is that God is preparing, God is fanning that flame, and now it's time, man. Now it's time with what's happening here in this country, with the attacks and all the stuff, the election, all the stuff that's going on. You know, we're in the greatest time, the greatest history, that's happening in front of us. Man, but let's not let that ship go by without us being the men that God called us to do, to share the gospel, to minister to the lost, and love on those that are unlovable. You know, preach the gospel, lead people to the Lord.
You know, we're speaking of this after, you know, what's happening in the world. That's a rebellious people. Look what he did for Israel when they were so rebellious and run away from
him.
They let their Chaldeans go. Just turn them back to him. You know, that's what it is. This what's happening here, all of this looks dark and everything. It is dark, but it's to turn men back, his heart back to him. We got to get back to the heart of worship.
Yes.
When we do that, then the woman and the man,
I think that when you say man, you're referring to them both. That's what I think. Low man, woman man, and the real man. There's man in general.
Yeah, scripture, I don't know if we're going to close, but I just wanted to share this one scripture that if my people were called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, then I will forgive them. It says my people. And the first step is declaring his name, and the primary step is that when we humble ourselves and pray, prayer brings revival. Unless you have a hunger for prayer, you're not going to have it. We've seen revivals throughout the year, and every one of those revivals all began on the knees.
Yeah, and you know where the prayer originates from? From the heart of everyone that humbles himself and prays.
Right.
Then you have the...
When we grieve and our spirit is just turning and hurting, and when you're called into that, then, Lord, bring me there. I'm not there. Lord, make me a prayer warrior, Lord.
Make me like you, Lord.
So how do we become more effective prayer? We hide his word where?
In our hearts.
Yes, sir.
Oh, one thing
I just like to say this in prayer and reflection to the faith that I practice, but in respect for everybody, I'm going to say it out loud. It's like, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, pray for us now at our death. Amen. I don't know if I said it completely right. Maybe you've heard it before. But what the concept is that if anybody's going to listen to us, it's the mother of Christ. Because if we ask her humbly, she's going to ask her son. And how can a son turn down his mother? Amen.
Father, we thank you again, and we praise your holy name, for you are our one and only true God, Lord. We love you, we praise you, we give and bow unto you, Lord.
Yes.
Father, we ask that you pour your spirit upon us, Lord. Fan the flames of the of those embers that are in our hearts, Lord Father, that we are be able to be stand up as an army, Lord Father. Just like my brother was saying here, Lord Father, the enemy is coming and he causes these things to happen, and then that remnant is going to come up. They're going to take that banner. They're going to take their shields and their spears, and we're going to fight. But Father, let us fight now. Father, I just pray that among us that there'll be men that have a burning desire in their heart to pray and be those prayer warriors. Prayer is what ushers revival. And that's what we need, revival in this country. We need a great awakening throughout this world, Lord. And Father, you've done it in the past. There's been great revival throughout this history where men have come back to the Father. And Father, we need that today. We need a great awakening in our churches, in our lives, Lord Father. So I just pray, Lord, that you just give us that heart of prayer so that we could seek you, Father. We're able to humble ourselves on our knees and pray. Father, we thank you, we praise you in Christ's holy name.
Amen. Amen. Amen.